Furthermore, these people walked to the hole from wherever they were at the time of the crash. How could this woman walk through burning jet fuel? How could she survive fires that were so intense that they were allegedly capable of destroying a steel structure? To put that another way, how could a fire destroy a massive steel structure if it was not capable of destroying human life? Obviously, some areas were not soaked with jet fuel, and as we stated before, the fires were not everywhere. This would explain why the holes were so devoid of flames. We can see this woman because she was brave enough to walk to the very edge of the hole, but there may be other people further inside who are staying away from the hole. We can see this man because he is next to a broken window, but we cannot see into the windows because of the glare, so it's possible that there are other people near him or behind the glass. What are the chances that only two people survived the airplane crash and fires, and both of them were coincidentally caught in this photo? It would seem that other people also survived, but we cannot see them. They may be trying to get down the stairs. As is explained in more detail in the book, there is no evidence that the fires in these towers were extreme. In fact, the fire in the Meridian Plaza office building in Philadelphia in 1991 was much worse, and that stood firm with little fundamental structural damage. The fire in the South Tower was so small that it did not even spread from one side of the floor to the other. The people who jumped out the windows created the illusion that the fire was so intense that they would rather jump than be burned by the fire. However, the photos do not show fire in the area where these people were jumping. Rather, the photos show lots of smoke. The smoke and the lack of flames are evidence that the fires were not getting enough oxygen. This would cause the plastic and rubber to create toxic fumes. This in turn could cause people to jump to avoid a slow, agonizing death from toxic smoke. The maximum temperature hydrocarbons can reach in the atmosphere is about 1800 degrees Fahrenheit. However, that maximum temperature can be reached only when the hydrocarbons and the air are mixed in perfect proportions. These perfect proportions are reached only in a few controlled situations, such as on a kitchen stove. This produces flames that are clean and blue rather than yellow. Even though stoves reach the maximum possible temperature, they do not melt or shatter into pieces. So how could even lower temperatures cause the towers to disintegrate? Controlled Demolition is a company that demolishes old buildings. They demolished the building in Oklahoma City that Timothy McVeigh was accused of blowing up. They were also hired to clean up the mess at the World Trade Center. They developed a special explosive and technique for using it for demolishing steel structures. They are so proud of this technology that they trademarked its abbreviation. Their British division describes the technology as follows. Our Drex systems segment steel components into pieces matching the lifting capacity of the available moving equipment. In other words, if your trucks can hold pieces of steel up to 24 feet in length, then this company will cause all steel assemblies to break into sections of 24 feet or less. Look at the rubble of the World Trade Center. Is it a coincidence that the entire steel framework of both towers broke into pieces no longer than the trucks that were hauling them away? Only a few of the thousands of pieces had to be cut with torches. Somehow, an off-center fire did exactly what controlled demolition does with their special trademark explosives. NASA and the U.S. Geological Survey created this thermal map of the temperature of the rubble. This map was created 5 days after the towers were attacked. Obviously, the rubble would be cooler after 5 days than it was on September 11th. Firefighters sprayed millions of gallons of water on the rubble during those 5 days, and it also rained. However, one location in the rubble of Building 7, with little fire, was above the melting point of aluminum, and so was one location in the rubble of the South Tower. Not surprisingly, smoke came out of the rubble for months. Peter Tully, president of one company hired to remove the debris, and Mark Loiseau, president of Controlled Demolition, told the American Free Press that steel had melted in the basements of both the towers and also Building 7. These incredible temperatures are evidence that explosives were used. Jet fuel cannot reach these temperatures. The explosives in the basements had to be powerful to break apart the massive steel beams. Explosives create very high temperatures, and the heat had nowhere to go since it was deep underground. According to the scientists who analyzed the seismic data, the North Tower collapsed in about 8 seconds. The collapse started at about the 94th floor near this woman. This means that 94 floors shattered at an average rate of about 10 floors per second. This means that the North Tower collapsed as fast as objects fall under gravity with no resistance. Explosives were shattering the tower slightly faster than the rubble was falling. The towers were built by the government, so taxpayers owned both of them. However, somehow the government was convinced to lease the towers for 99 years, and Larry Silverstein became landlord on July 24th, less than 2 months before the attack. He then had control of the maintenance and security departments, and he began to replace security personnel. Silverstein brought Frank Lowy into the deal to become landlord of the underground shopping mall. Lowy is a billionaire who owns shopping malls in several nations. After the towers disintegrated, Silverstein demanded insurance companies pay him twice what the policy stated, on the grounds that each tower underwent separate attacks. What a coincidence that after these guys got control of the World Trade Center, Osama bin Laden decided to destroy the entire complex. The packages of explosives would have to be placed in an area above the ceiling tiles. Each package would have a battery and a radio receiver. A computer would be able to detonate the explosives in any sequence by sending the appropriate signals to the packages. To summarize, the 9/11 Commission ignored the following facts. Building 7 at the World Trade Center was never hit by an airplane and had no significant fire. It was 47 floors tall, constructed of steel, and a different design than the Twin Towers. Yet it fell straight down into a pile of rubble at 5:30 p.m., just like a controlled demolition. The Federal Emergency Management Agency reported that the specifics of the fires in World Trade Center 7 and how they caused the building to collapse remain unknown. Concerning the Twin Towers, in October of 2001, Scientific American told us that they just don't build them as tough as the World Trade Center. Since the Meridian Plaza in Philadelphia burned fiercely for 19 hours yet never collapsed, why did the South Tower at the World Trade Center fall after burning less than 1 hour, and the North Tower fall after burning only 2? This is even more puzzling considering that the Federal Emergency Management Agency has told us that most of the jet fuel was burned in the initial fireball, and recent fire tests by Cardington found that a steel building survived fires in experiments with extreme temperatures beyond the range possible with jet fuel. Moreover, the black smoke means that the fire was oxygen-starved and could not have reached the maximum potential temperature of 1800 degrees Fahrenheit. Yet cleanup crews found melted steel in the basements. Steel melts at a much higher temperature of 2500 degrees Fahrenheit. Days later, NASA images found hot spots in the building that still exceeded the maximum temperatures possible from jet fuel, but not from explosives like C4, which creates temperatures of 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Fire Engineering magazine has told us that no steel building has ever been destroyed by fire, that the World Trade Center investigation was a half-baked farce, and that all of the important evidence was destroyed illegally before the investigation was concluded, some before it began. Why was $40 million spent on Clinton's sex life, while only $600,000 was spent on investigating the World Trade Center fires and collapses? The entire 9/11 Commission spent only $15 million, while all expenditures on Clinton's indiscretion exceeded $65 million.